It's December 14th, 2006, and we're in the home of Chuck and Margaret Gray in Fairbanks, Alaska. And today we're going to be interviewing Chuck for the Conserving Our Wildlife Conservation Heritage, which is a program in the Wildlife Society. And assisting with the interview today is Dr. Roger Kaye. Roger is a pilot and wilderness specialist with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service here in Fairbanks, Alaska, and he has interviewed Mr. Gray in the past. So I'll turn it over to Roger to start the interview.
Oh. Well, thanks, and gee, thanks for talking to me again here, Chuck. last time we got together, we talked about what brought you to Alaska during the war years and your progression as a newspaper editor at the News Miner. So today we'd like to focus more specifically on your work and other activities related to wildlife. So, if you don't mind, we'd like to begin with your earliest childhood and wondering what is it that led to your very strong interest in wildlife? What early influences, experiences, or perhaps magazine or book readings that may have stimulated what you did?
Well, we came from central Illinois and came to Alaska in the fall of 1943, mm-hmm. and at that time I was 15, finished high school here. But before that, growing up actually in Peoria, which is a fair-sized city there, mm-hmm. Our relatives were almost all farmers. So my brother and I spent most of the good part of the summers on farms. Mm. And my dad hunted quail a lot, mm-hmm. and I guess some of my earliest recollections were going out with him and in the winter there, maybe a little skiff of snow on, and mm-hmm. finding some covey of pheasants, and about the only other thing that we hunted were cottontail rabbits, mm. a few squirrels, I guess. Mm-hmm. But so my dad hunted to that extent. And he had grown up, of course, on a farm. So when the opportunity came to come to Alaska during the World War II, he was a carpenter and worked at the Caterpillar Tractor Company at that time. So there was a priority on jobs during the war, but the Alaska highway jobs had a higher priority than the Caterpillar Tractor Company did, I guess. So he was able to hire out, come to Alaska. Mm-hmm. He came to Skagway first in the spring of 43 and found that to be a pretty small town as far as schools were concerned. But Fairbanks was a much larger place of like 4,500 people there. And so he transferred here with the same company and then sent for us near the fall of 43. So that's how I got here. Mm-hmm.
So when you were a kid, a small kid, is there anything that, you know, magazines you read or books that influenced your thinking, do you think?
If there were, I don't remember. Mm-hmm. There were magazines around, like I think Sports Afield or whatever. Mm-hmm. Field and Stream, maybe, in those days, mm-hmm. around the home, mm-hmm. but being basically farm people, hunting and killing animals was not at all strange thing to do.
Yeah. How old were you when you got your first .22?
I don't think I ever had a .22 till I came to Alaska, but I had a single shot .410 shotgun.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. I remember I occasionally would get a quail with that. Mm-hmm.
So how did you merge into becoming the outdoorsman you became? Now, a lot of people in Fairbanks hunt and fish and some even trap, but you did everything. A master guide, a riverboat man, a pilot, everything.
Well, it happened in stages over the years. My dad, even though he was working pretty long hours when he first got here, he fairly soon build a riverboat, so a lot of the hunting in those days were by riverboat, so we could not only hunt the Chena, but up the Tananaw to Healy Lake or mm-hmm. whatever was exciting to do in those days. So, and then I was out of high school in 46, and I was invited to join a couple other fellows to buy an airplane. So I got a pilot's license in 48, and I actually had a float rating first because it was a float plane. So that's what I learned on, and then got a wheel rating later, and after it came off the float. So, and just one thing and another happened like that. I liked to hunt, and during the Korean War, I was drafted from Alaska and took basic in Anchorage, and was sent back to Fairbanks, Eielson actually, to become actually a first military game warden there. So that introduced me to the what the people that managed fish and game in Alaska at that time was the Fish and Wildlife Service. And so I had an opportunity to work with some of them, and particularly notable was Frank Glazier, who was the predator control agent. And so those type of things just happened and led me along.
Well, before we get into Frank, which I understand was a big influence, how did you get selected to be a military game warden?
Well, Ray Wolford was in charge of the Fairbanks office for Fish and Wildlife, and he knew me, and I don't really remember talking to him about it, but they already had a game warden program at Elmendorf and Ladd Field, and Ray was interested in getting one started at Eielson because it was just being built up then. It, you know, it was actually built during World War II, but never used. So it was kind of reactivated in later years. And so by 1951, there was Ray was instrumental in getting the program extended there. So somewhere or other, a master sergeant was chosen from the Air Force, and I was a buck private in the Army, just out of basic, but I was chosen as the other one, and we were so I was on special duty to the Air Police. We had an office in the Air Police office, or we had a desk there anyway, and our main purpose was to indoctrinate new troops coming in, and sell licenses, and and assist the civilians on weekend patrol trips and that type of thing.
Did you do law enforcement?
Yeah, that was basically what we did. We kind of worked, there was no problem when we worked with the civilian, but there's a an act called the Posse Comitatus Act that prevents military people from from arresting civilian people or going in your home, that type of thing. So we tried to work with them that way. There were some times when we worked separately. I remember one time the Air Force guy and I got a commendation because we solved some illegal caribou hunting on the 40-mile road or around Mount Fairplay. Turned out to be some CAA fellas from Northway, the Northway FA fellas, CAA in those days, station. And so we identified and talked to them and got confessions. But then when it came to actually processing the violations and TOPE for a commissioner, why Ray Wolford handled that part. So we kind of dodged the act that way.
In the course of your work as a warden, was that kind of your introduction to interacting with some of the biologists, like with the Bureau of Sport Fisheries and Wildlife, to perhaps work with on game surveys or things like that?
Yeah, definitely. The office was very small here then. In fact, there really wasn't a full-time biologist at that time. The Ed Chatelaine would come up from Anchorage once in a while, and the wildlife unit was just being established at the university with Dr. Buckley. mm-hmm. and Neil Hosley first, I guess, and let's see, there was another biologist out there that got interested in sheep work. Well, I don't remember his name right at the moment, but so yeah, I had association with all of them, and occasional field trip with Ray, but mostly the opportunity was to work with Frank Glazier. He was always in need of a pilot, and he kind of took a back seat to for aircraft stuff for the other work that was being done, which is mainly enforcement. So yeah, I got to know, and Jim King came on during my time, but as an enforcement trainee. Then later he went on to become a waterfowl specialist, you know. And so anyway, yeah, we got to know them all. And the Air Force guy preferred to hang around the base, and I prefer not to, so it worked out well for me.
So you hung out in the office downtown here, is that right?
Yeah. Huh? Yeah, the office was over on 2nd Avenue, mm-hmm. Over up on the second floor of some buildings that was actually next to the Model Cafe.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
So everybody in the town that wanted to buy a license even had to mm-hmm. go up there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, of course, a small town in those days.
Mm-hmm.
I think kind of an interesting thing happened, though. If you wanted to buy a license, you had to get there during office hours, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They closed at 5.
Mm-hmm.
And the secretary there would, you know, issue a license. So one time Ray had the idea, why not just open at 9 and go till 6?
Mm-hmm.
And that way you could serve the public better mm-hmm. after work or whatever.
Well,
the guy in Juneau, Howard Balso was his name. He was kind of the administrative guy down there.
Mm-hmm.
He heard about these new office hours in Fairbanks. So
mm-hmm.
one time he wanted to check up on it. So he called like at 8:30 or something. He tried to call the office. Well, he got the, of course, got the local operator.
Mm-hmm.
And she knew that Ray wasn't open at that time, so she rang Ray's home phone.
Mm-hmm.
And Ray also wanted some paperwork or wanted to know something. That was mm-hmm. his excuse for calling.
Oh.
So Ray, I guess he opens the oven door and slams it a few times and stuff, and he says, "I can't find that in a file, you know. You'll have to wait till Rose gets here, you know."
Yeah, very nice.
So anyway, he changed the hours back.
Hmm. Interesting. Yeah. Well, gosh, this was during the campaign for statehood. It was a pretty major issue at that time, I imagine. What was your thinking about whether a new state of Alaska would be better for wildlife management or worse? I know people felt both ways, and there was some argument whether a new state would be as willing to do conservation work as the feds.
I think that my feeling, as I remember, was kind of neutral.
Mm.
The feds at that time were pretty well respected. They thought they were doing a pretty good job, except on the fisheries and you know, mm-hmm. in southeastern,
mm-hmm.
the fish traps and stuff. But in the interior, I think there was some question of whether or not it could be improved.
Mm-hmm.
And of course the state began to have build up a department to show that they maybe would be ready for something.
Mm-hmm.
They put one sport fish guy up here, Ed Marvey,
mm.
began to do a little bit with sport fish.
Like mm-hmm.
they poisoned Birch Lake and put some rainbow in, things like that,
oh.
for
mm-hmm.
statehood. And but I guess it was, we realized it's going to be a challenge
mm-hmm.
to match the quality of work that was being done.
Mm. So did you support statehood yourself?
Yeah, more or less. I worked at the newspaper then. Newspaper was...
Snedden was all for it.
Yeah, definitely. And so it seemed like most people did, I think.
Mm-hmm. But in the mid-1950s, was there perceived to be a real challenge or a need to manage game species for abundance? In other words, was the population density getting high enough around here that people were, had the general feeling that there needed to be active management such as predator control to increase numbers to provide for people? Or is that not as big of an issue at that point yet in the mid-1950s?
It wasn't an issue because predator control was being done, and very effectively. There was only one man in the interior that worked at it, but...
It was Glasser?
Yeah. And, of course, his main tools were poison, and that worked very effectively. So, and you know, hunting pressure was still light in the mid-50s, and there was enough game, pretty much. So, no, that wasn't an issue at all then.
But there was a big effort on the part of some conservationists to end the bounty system.
That's right. It was, the bounty system was left over from years earlier.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty well recognized by the time we're talking about the 50s,
mm-hmm.
that the bounty system wasn't effective, that you took an occasional animal here or there,
mm-hmm.
and not enough to be to affect the mm-hmm. pack size or anything mm-hmm. beyond the next breeding season.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was just a bonus to trappers was all it was.
Oh, yeah? Uh-huh.
It was recognized mm-hmm. as that then.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. And you were an aerial wolf hunter yourself during much of that time, weren't you?
Later.
That was later.
Yeah, in the 60s and early 70s mm-hmm. is when we did some of that.
So when were you involved officially in wolf control, predator control then?
Officially, you mean work with Frank Glaser?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, that had been the 2 years I was in the military, 51 and 52.
I see. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So did you get involved in the local conflict that I know some people were very much against wolf control and especially the bounty system, or was that an issue you were involved in here? Or?
Well, I don't remember being there'd be an occasional trapper that would complain in the office about somebody put poison out and killed all the game off, all the wolves or something, and it was usually turned out to be an area that Frank hadn't done anything in.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. No, it was an accepted thing then.
Mm-hmm.
The opposition was very minor.
Mm-hmm. And the Fish and Wildlife Service condoned it and actually did it themselves, didn't they?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Right.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
After I was out of that, just as I was getting out of the military in 52, a pilot agent came on. His name was Joe Miner.
Mm-hmm.
And he worked with Frank then up right up to statehood
mm-hmm.
when programs were eliminated,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
58 or 59.
Mm-hmm. Did Frank use military planes for his efforts? Do you have access to military planes for some of his control efforts?
No, not mm-hmm. normally.
Mm-hmm.
He worked along the highway systems quite a bit. He used these coyote getters,
mm-hmm.
Cyanide gas guns,
mm-hmm.
Along the highways and mm-hmm. in the summertime. That was more effective in the summertime. You could keep them active. They'd work
mm-hmm.
then.
Mm-hmm.
The trouble with them was that once one wolf pulled one, while the other rest of the pack was, you know, was sensitive to that particular smell.
Uh-huh.
So he had to keep changing scents.
Oh, really?
To keep them active.
Yeah.
Whereas the wintertime control was with strychnine.
Mm.
And and that was much more effective because you often could get the whole pack by putting out these strychnine baits around a moose kill or something.
So during that transition period from territory to statehood, I know there was conflict between Fish and Wildlife Service, Clarence Road in particular, and the Fish and Game Commissioner, or soon to be Commissioner Clarence Anderson. Were you involved or aware of that tension between the two competing organizations?
No, I don't remember being.
So overall, do you think wildlife management improved after Alaska became a state?
Well, it became a entirely different thing. In the earlier days up to statehood, it was mainly a matter of enforcement of game laws. And after that, as the population increased and the hunting pressures increased, it became more important to try to maintain game populations, at least control them by other means that the biologists were involved in.
So it was during this time that you, is that when you became, I guess, your interest in wildlife, what interested me was they're so vast across the state where a lot of guides specialize in an area. You were hunting polar bears in the Northeast Arctic and walrus out west and the Brooks Range and the Wrangells, and I mean, you were conducting hunts all over the place. What led you to such wide-ranging interests?
Well, the reason I became a guide was about as soon as I got out of the military, I had an uncle in Illinois that was interested in coming to Alaska to hunt. And of course, he would have to have a guide for about any big game at that time. So I asked Wilford about taking the guides test, and I took that and passed it okay. And the other part was you had to be recommended by a guide. So Frank Glazier had been a guide before he worked for the federal agency. So Frank recommended me for a...
Oh, really?
Yeah, we'd spent a lot of time in the field together, you know. So that's the way I got started.
Well, it's quite an honor to have him recommend you.
Yeah, I'm probably the only one he ever did that.
Oh, really?
And so I took my uncle that fall, and my uncle sent a couple other fellows up the next year, and it just grew. I never did a big volume. During the main years I was guiding, I'd take about 7 weeks off from work a year, and guide about a month in the fall, and maybe 3 weeks in the spring with polar bear, maybe a week down the peninsula on brown bear or something. And so it was always just supposed to be kind of a hobby. Kind of was.
And where did you go for walrus?
In St. Lawrence Island.
Oh, really? Now, did you fly your cub all over?
No. No, not there. I did everywhere else.
You did?
But no, we chartered out of Nome.
And because of your wide-ranging travels as a guide, both before statehood and after, would you commonly go and testify on some of the game issues to the Alaska Game Commission or the Board of Game subsequent to statehood? In other words, bring your experience about what you've observed about population levels, predator levels, prey levels, how fires have influenced habitat, things like that. Did you try to get involved with providing that information to the decision-making bodies?
After statehood, advisory system was eventually set up, and actually I was on the Fairbanks Advisory Committee at one time, but yeah, we often testified, or I did too. Sometimes written opinions about things. I was always pretty much an advocate of predator control, so famous for sticking to that subject.
So in the early 50s, at some point you joined the Tonto Valley Sportsmen, and you were a board officer actually for quite a while, I understand. I remember you were a secretary and signed a lot of the correspondence. So what led you and a group of other people in Fairbanks here to establish the Interior Wildlife Association? I remember that sprung up in the mid-70s, and I think you told me before it had 5,000 members at one point.
Well, the way that happened was there were six of us in town that that were friends, and we'd become kind of incensed over some of the things that were going on during Commissioner Brooks' tenure.
As Fish and Game Commissioner.
Yeah, okay. State Fish and Game Commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to, and then the other thing that was going on is we recognized that the moose population over in 20A had pretty much crashed.
That's the Cannonau Flats, south
yes,
of town here.
Okay. South of town. And the department didn't seem to be aware of it or concerned about it.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought, well, let's kind of get together and see if we can form an organization to do something about these things. By that time, the Tano Valley Sportsman Association had pretty much backed away from abdicating and enacting as an advisory committee to whatever agency was running Fish and Game.
Mm-hmm.
In the earlier days, they were quite active. They mm-hmm. had yearly meetings or one or two meetings to discuss those kind of things, and we had one of the, before statehood, one of the game commissioners, Forbes Baker, actually lived in Fairbanks, and so we had TBSA mm-hmm. had his ear,
mm-hmm.
and so that's kind of the way it worked then. Well, the TBSA became more of a pistol and rifle club,
mm-hmm.
and they kind of backed away from abdicating things, so we kind of filled a void for about 10 years with our organization, and then eventually AOC came along, the Alaska Outdoor Coalition, which is a statewide group
mm-hmm.
that could do a better job than we
mm.
could do as a little local group.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of our members were actually out of state. For some reason or other, through our newsletter, it brought us in memberships.
Mm-hmm.
So we could claim a fair membership at one time. And we had some interesting things that happened with that. Probably the most dramatic was at one point we sued the state over giving away muskox to Russia.
Mm-hmm.
And that got us quite a bit of press, and mm-hmm. The federal government had through Nixon, I guess, had made an agreement to trade some muskox to the Russians in exchange for Siberian polecats,
oh, yeah.
whatever they are. mm. It's actually I can show you that in print, and. Jim Brooks went along with it
mm-hmm.
Without any action by game board or anything else. And so at that time, the feds seemed to be re-encroaching on game management in Alaska. This would be in 75, I think, mm-hmm. 1975, in that, very close there anyway. And so they'd already rounded up 40 muskox from Nunavak, and the Russians would have landed on at Nunavak, except the airstrip wasn't big enough there for their transport plane. So they landed at Bethel, and Weens ferried these muskox over to Bethel in a sky van.
Mm.
And they were all ready to leave, and we got an injunction to keep them from being released. So the state troopers were there guarding these muskox to be sure that the Russians didn't get them until the court case was settled.
Mm-hmm.
And quite a few things happened as a result of that. Eventually, the Russians got their muskox.
Mm.
I don't know if we got the polecats. The feds backed off from trying to manage and conduct the hunt And they before they hadn't done anything about range management or anything there, or reducing the herd. They agreed to let the state do that. And so, and the judge said that all animals in Alaska, but where, whatever kind of land they're on, belong to the state. So there's a lot of pretty important decisions came out of that.
And was that your intent to set some precedents for the bigger issue?
Exactly. Yes.
Right. The state. It's a
I
state.
I would say mainly to try to slow the federal encroachment back into wildlife management.
In that context, this was in the mid 1970s. Was the Interior Alaska Wildlife Association involved in some of the comments on the D2 selections that eventually led up to ANILCA in terms of federal lands would be going to parks and refuges and how that might influence wildlife management?
Yes, definitely. In our newsletter, we spent quite a bit of space on explaining what was happening. None of us were very effective, of course. It all pretty much happened the way it was outlined. You know, the people in Washington wanted to do it. But we had a lot to say. We would testify at, I remember I went to Anchorage one time and testified at how some of these boundaries were being drawn, And there was a little effect in some cases, but not much. In the end, something like 50 or 60% of the sheep ranges went into federal preserves and things like that. We weren't very effective.
A lot of sportsmen at that time were categorically against any D2 or ANILCA unit setup. How did you feel? Did you support some but not others? Or did you generally support ANILCA with reservations?
I other than recognizing it was inevitable, I think we naturally tended to, and myself tended to resist it all. And it started out poorly, with the Antiquities Act being imposed to lock up everything in Alaska. So it just got off to a bad start and kind of went downhill from there.
Yeah, the Antiquities Act set the stage, and I remember a common criticism was ANILCA was largely driven by outsiders, people outside of Alaska. Was that a big concern of yours in sportsmen here?
Yeah, definitely. That was the impression we all had, pretty rightly, I think.
So looking back from the perspective of today, was ANILCA as bad as people feared, or not as much so, or... can you reckon?
As far as sportsmen go?
Yeah.
I think it's probably as bad as we expected. We've learned to live with it, and a younger generation has come up not knowing any different.
Yeah. They never knew the freedoms that you had.
Yeah, exactly.
I remember when we talked before, you talked about the golden days of hunting during the war years and right after, and what was lost. And you've often talked about a hunting ethic that perhaps has changed, and you wanted to keep the tradition of hunting alive. You tell us a little bit about your idea of what hunting is and should remain, and where that's going today.
Well, when I got into guiding, my idea there was... I kind of enjoyed doing it on kind of a one-to-one basis with a hunter. And while it was no longer practical to maintain a bunch of pack horses and go out for a month and that type of thing, either in my case or anybody for that matter, there were still a couple people doing it. But guiding with a lot of the guides had just become a wholesale thing. Hire some assistants that are not too well qualified, pick up whoever you can, and sign on all the hunters you can can get, and use an airplane to spot game and even drop in on it and whatever. It just became kind of disgusting. Mm. I always enjoyed it when you didn't have pressure to produce under any conditions, and it was not, it didn't need to be my principal income. Mm-hmm. So that made a lot of difference. Mm-hmm. And I think guiding is still pretty much that way. It could have been better if we still had a guide board that could allocate areas and that type of thing. Mm-hmm. We did at one time, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like you could call it exclusive areas for the guides to work in. Mm-hmm. The state residents, you know, were not, they'd go where they wanted anybody's guide area, but mm-hmm. you couldn't have two guides in an area. Mm-hmm. And that worked pretty well for quite a few years, but then some guide that was disgruntled over not getting an area he wanted took it to court, and it took several years to wind its way through, but eventually he won. Mm-hmm. So it threw out that exclusive district area, the mm-hmm. idea, and which was unfortunate, because even one of the state supreme justices said that if the state had done a better job presenting this guide concept as a conservation measure, in other words, to for the good of the game, mm-hmm. that it might not have been thrown out.
Oh, really?
So it was kind of a black eye for the state's case, you know. But mm-hmm. nevertheless, it happened, and it's kind of chaos now.
Mm-hmm. Except in a few refuges where they went back to that state allocation system.
Yeah, that's right. The refuges are a better deal now, the federal refuges. Mm-hmm.
And how about the other aspects of the hunting ethic? You know, you hear a lot of hunters even concerned about the increasing, say, mechanization of hunting and maybe the use of ATVs, not just for access to the hunting area, but for actually hunting itself, and concerned that the ethic and the tradition of hunting is going downhill. What do you think of that? Is that happening? Or
I think it is, sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the ATV equipment is more sophisticated, mm-hmm. and you can get around a lot more with it now, and again, just so many more hunters are pushing things harder and mm-hmm. further, and yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm not a very active hunter anymore, so mm-hmm. I can't, you know, my opinion is not based on real current, mm-hmm. but except through friends and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you can just look at the Outdoor Channel and see the gadgets and the commercialization of hunting and wonder where the ethic's going. Some of the things that I know you've talked about in the past about maintaining this tradition as an honorable tradition is really at risk, it seems.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, this fall when those people drove their pickups off and off of the Dalton Highway to try to pick up some caribou they'd shot way mm-hmm. off. Mm-hmm. It's kind of an example of what can happen if things are left wide open. Mm-hmm. You know, Senator Seekins pushed to open some of that country mm-hmm. to for better access that way. Mm-hmm. And while normally his views and actions on fishing game are good, I think that irritated a lot of even sportsmen, mm-hmm. And might probably one reason that he didn't get reelected. Mm-hmm. So there's a concern over those kind of things, but mm-hmm. it's hard to keep ahead of the equipment that's available now.
Yeah. And the ethic to keep up with the technology and the gadgets, I guess, that yeah. seem to define hunting. You know, I didn't ask about trapping, and I know you did trap for a while. When did you start trapping, and where did you trap?
Well, I actually, some of this stuff on the wall or my trophies, I guess. Mm-hmm. I trapped a little bit in high school. Another mm-hmm. kid and I trapped beaver locally here.
Oh, mm-hmm.
But I really never trapped until I retired.
Oh, really?
In 1992.
All right.
And then I kind of need something else to do. And,
mm-hmm.
and I was crippled enough by that time that I couldn't climb mountains anymore. So we had a cabin in a lake west of here, mm-hmm. out in the flats. And mm-hmm. So I just thought maybe I'd do a little trapping there.
Mm.
So it's pretty recreational, but
mm-hmm.
I pick up 15 or 20 martin a season and maybe a wolf or two sometimes.
Well, that's pretty good. Not many people start that late in life. Well, all the places you've hunted and all the different things you've hunted in Alaska, what's your fondest memories?
Oh, well, of course, sheep hunting is my favorite thing to hunt. And I kind of followed that from the two jacks, the Wrangles,
mm-hmm.
To the Brooks Range as things became more populated and,
mm-hmm.
and pressure increased on that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Hunted out of McCarthy for a few
mm-hmm.
years,
mm-hmm.
and that gave me access to the upper Chittenah and over into the Scolai Basin and the White mm-hmm. River Country. And pretty soon, Cordova Air Service was dropping people off all around. And,
mm-hmm.
and so I moved to the Alaska Range
mm-hmm.
and hunted there a few years. I had a couple of airstrips I put in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then when that got a little more populated, I moved to the Brooks Range pretty much and began to hunt up there in 1957, I think.
Mm-hmm. That's in the Arctic Refuge?
It was at that time it was over more in the NOTAC country.
Oh, the NOTAC, okay.
The Latin and NOTAC.
So as the small airplanes became available, that was a fairly quick progression from when you were hunting in the Wrangles, then moving to the Alaska Range, and moving to the Brooks Range, period of a few years then in the 50s.
That's right. What changed it so much was when the Super Cub came out in 1948, I guess. I didn't have one until 1954, but I did have access to a Taylor craft with a large engine in, which performed almost as good as a Super Cub.
Mm.
So that's what I was using actually in Wrangell.
Mm-hmm.
In 1954, Cubs, or by 48, I think the Cubs were being manufactured, and by 1952 they had the 125 horse engine and even better performance flaps and everything by that year. So, and then the balloon tires came along and just gave us access to about anywhere, the river bars and ridges and whatever. Where you get by with. So that changed things a lot.
And I remember you were kind of a pioneer in that emerging new powerful Super Cub, and I think you once told me that it made you aware of, maybe ahead of other people, a potential threat that kind of access could provide for wilderness hunting.
Yeah, it certainly did. It brought on the mass-produced hunts that I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
Because I could get around. Mm-hmm. I'd even in the Brooks Range, why from our camp we finally established there, I have was able to get a headquarters site before
mm-hmm.
all the land freezes came on.
Mm-hmm.
And so from about 1965, I hunted out of one camp we had there.
Mm-hmm.
And I could be up on the mountains and see an airplane way off somewhere had landed on a ridge to
mm-hmm.
pursue a bunch of rams just for a day hunt, you know, that
mm-hmm.
type of thing. So, that happened.
Mm-hmm.
Based on the greater access that the more powerful engines and the improvements that technology came along, What can you tell us about the history of the prohibition of using helicopters for hunting or transporting hunters in the field? When did that come about? And were you involved at all with lobbying for that kind of a prohibition?
I wasn't involved because it was always a prohibition, right from the first. The military got some bad press because some of their officers and things that used helicopters. And so I think from the time there was ever a civilian model here, it was prohibited.
Would that have been the 1950s, some of the early ones, or was it later than that when they first became available to civilian use?
It would be about early 50s, I think.
Okay.
No, I don't think any of us ever thought it would be a good idea. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have a few times up in the hills back up. But no, it would have. If the Super Cub was a disaster, well, that would have been far worse.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question. Let's suppose our new governor calls you up tomorrow and says, you're the new commissioner of fish and game. You can do it right here from Fairbanks. You don't have to move to Juneau. You can do anything you want, politics notwithstanding. What would you do in an ideal state if you were commissioner of fish and game?
Well, we can't name names, can we?
If you want.
I don't know. I'm pretty involved with the, not involved, but I'm concerned and interested in the fish stocking, the sport fish stocking program mm-hmm. in the interior, because that's one thing I can still do is fish. Mm-hmm. And the guys here have had a tough go because they're subservient to what happens in Anchorage. Mm. You know, for a long time we wanted a hatchery here. Mm-hmm. And finally, mainly through one person here that's persevered in the department and two or three state legislatures that got mm-hmm. behind it. Why it looked like we could actually have one here. You know, the department prematurely closed the clear hatchery mm-hmm. several years ago. And so this project of getting the hatchery here is drug along. And mm-hmm. finally, there was a state bonding for it. But, of course, the Anchorage had to get a bunch of money out of the bond. And Kodiak and so forth mm-hmm. had to get a little their finger in it for this and that. So I don't know if we're ever going to get a hatchery actually built here, and I know it's not going to be the size or anything that mm-hmm. was once thought about or needed. Mm-hmm. So I think I would change the sport fish head in Anchorage first thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, how about subsistence? I know you've had a lot of experience working with rural people in the early days, and you helped at least one become a hunting guide, as I recall, someone from Arctic. And it's the source of much of the contention between the states and the feds on the game wildlife issues. How would you resolve it if you had the ability to do so?
Well, I don't know if there is any way to resolve it. I certainly feel for the people and villages that attempt to carry on a subsistence lifestyle. And yeah, we did work with various natives in our hunting days mm-hmm. and actually helped two of them in Arctic Village obtain licenses. Mm-hmm. Neither one of them did much with them, mm-hmm. but they had the opportunity. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, I guess I fall to the group that thinks that we're all pretty equal, and we ought to have equal access. To the extent that villages have a built-in advantage, because mm-hmm. they're right there, mm-hmm. They know where a moose is, mm-hmm. and usually, often the seasons have been set so that they have a the villages or the area where villages are mm-hmm. have a longer season mm-hmm. and those type of advantages, and it seems to me like that's enough without mm-hmm. trying to create these priorities by zip code mm-hmm. Where a rich merchant or something in a village mm-hmm. has more rights to go out and shoot a moose than I do. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If there was some way of giving the people that really need it, that were truly subsistence living, mm-hmm. Priority, I could go for that. But I can't figure out any way to do that. Nobody else has either.
Yeah. Mm. Well, those are the questions I had, Tom. You have anything? I've got a general one, but I'll end with that.
No, go ahead.
So what would you like to add in terms of perspective on wildlife and anything we didn't cover that?
I don't know. Seemed like we covered quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. What should Alaska become in terms of opportunities for the kinds of things that I think all three of us here find important?
Especially looking at the fact that, you know, population may well increase here into the future, and trying to maintain some of the experiences that we've had and the benefits that we've had, how to do that, or what might be one way to pursue that into the future.
Well, any way you do it, it becomes more restrictive. For instance, I don't think I'd find a lot of fun in hunting moose in various parts of the state anymore because of the complicated thing that you have to judge horns by size and brow tine lengths and all that type of thing, and I guess this comes with trying to restrict the take enough to maintain a herd. But I don't know, it's just a problem. You definitely have to put restrictions on as pressure increases. But I just feel so fortunate that I came up in an ideal era when we didn't need many restrictions, and we could pretty much do as we pleased as long as we were, I guess, set our own ethics and that type of thing. But I just don't think people, it's no wonder that people, the percentage of people that are hunting anymore, even Alaska is, you know, drops, and because you have to go through all these hurdles and the crowds out there and all that type of thing. So I don't think that answers your question, except that I'm just fortunate that I lived in the era I did.
No, it gives us a perspective in it, yeah.
Karen, do you have any questions?
Yeah, you were talking about you met your wife in Fort Yukon. How did you end up in Fort Yukon, and what was that, 1950? No, when was that?
It's probably about 19... we were married in 1962. So it must have been about 59 or something like that. I'd been on a hunting trip up in the Arctic Village area. And had the client with me, and we were trying to get back to Fairbanks, and weather was bad enough that I thought I'd better hang it up at Fort Yukon for the night. So Margaret was there as a public health nurse at the time, and everybody stayed in the one roadhouse and ate at the same table, of course. So it wasn't as if I hadn't met her before, but I'd heard about her. I think we had a mutual friend or two that had tried to get us together.
Oh, really?
So anyway, that started it more. Although she said I think I didn't write her for 2 years till, because she, or a year or two before, because she was in Nome for a while. So that happens anyway.
And so your career then was primarily in the newspaper business from about 1953 until you retired in 1992?
Well, I worked the paper before I went in the Army. In fact, I worked the paper while I was in the Army. As long as being a game warden, I also did the photo engraving for photos in the paper and evenings, like two or three evenings a week. Oh. So I'd come in to do that. And so I had a pretty continuous stretch for 48 years of the paper.
Wow.
And initially in the mechanical department, and then eventually in management, and I ended up actually as publisher of the paper. We sold a paper and I retired at that time. There was about four of us that were retirement age, and it was one of many factors that entered into the reason for selling.
Which paper was that?
The Fairbanks Daily Newsletter.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
And so you're publisher emeritus today. Do you still have some influence on editorial policy?
Very little. Mm-hmm. Although I'm not, if I see something in Fish and Game or whatever that ought to be touched on, I'll give them a call. I know, mm-hmm. know the principals there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they kind of, they'll at least listen to me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you think today, even with the fact that we've got more television and internet, that the local newspaper, like the Newsminer, still remains an important tool for the public to get opinion out about important wildlife management issues?
I think so. The brief things you hear on TV, for instance, about an issue hardly scratch the subject, whereas the papers maintained an outdoor editor for a good many years, and mm-hmm. and the present one does a pretty good job of covering subjects, and I think he's kind of non-predator control type, but he comes through in a few of his articles. But anyway, at least we get some depth that way, mm-hmm. and as all subjects are covered in greater depth in the paper than they can be on radio or TV. So now it still serves a good purpose. All newspapers are kind of struggling a little bit nowadays because their revenue sources are changing so much. The circulation of a paper, circulation revenue always amounted to something like 15% of your total revenue, and then the rest is display and classified advertisement, split about half and half. And display advertising, that's the big printed ads, and they've changed so much because you don't see the car ads or the grocery ads much anymore. They've gone to stuffers, which are pretty low revenue for a paper. For stuffers, you charge just enough so that you stay under postage if they were going to direct mail. So maybe where a grocery page used to be worth $1,000, for instance, why you can put a stuffer in with several pages for $600 or $700. From that standpoint, the revenue standpoint, newspapers they have to stay on. They have to be ever alert for every news source they can work. But I think I don't know what would fill the vacuum as far as in-depth news coverage goes.
Have you seen, like, when the Newsminer was bought out several years ago by a company outside in Denver or wherever, do you think, has that had an effect on the amount of local voice to cover some of these important resource issues like wildlife management because they're being controlled by an outside principal? Or?
No, I was, I was very concerned about that, but I have not seen any effect. In fact, outside of one or two issues that I know of, I don't believe there's been hardly any influence or effect or directive to do anything on any subjects. And in fact, the owners, there were two of them, they bought it individually, not as part of their chain. That's one thing we insisted on. They have a policy of if they buy a liberal paper, that it can stay liberal. If they buy a conservative paper, it can stay conservative. And in our case, I think we could accurately say that our paper maintained a, not exactly down the middle, but a slightly conservative stance on most issues, including renewable development and that type of thing.
Yeah. Well, I was just wondering if how the influence of non-residents compares in the, say, the territorial days and early statehood days with today. Do you think they have more or less influence on Alaska's wildlife management?
Not the individual non-residents, particularly the non-resident hunters, for instance, I don't think do, but the organized animal groups certainly do. Even on your organization, I see a...
It's Fish and Wildlife Service.
Fish and Wildlife. Yeah. I see a, you know, from my days, acquaintance with them when they were pro-predator control and and definitely pro-hunting and and all that is... They haven't done a complete switch like the... National Wildlife Federation has, or something like that. But there's a concern, I think, that let's keep a lid on this stuff. And for instance, I think the big holdup for introducing the wood bison back into the Yukon Flats, for instance, has been the feds, and you know, for no good reason. What the heck? The natives finally came around, and everybody else, except it's a refuge, and you can't put some exotic animal in there, even though they used to be there. So, what kind of a question did you ask me, brother?
I was just wondering. I think that largely it reflects the national interest in the Alaska National Interest Lands Conservation Act that Alaskans were so concerned about, that it is a larger interest than that of just Alaskans.
Yeah, your director in Washington, I'm sure, gets a lot more push to keep the lid on things than certainly any of you get in Alaska, I think.
Well, that's what I have. Do either of you have anything more?
I'm not on camera, but I can be on the audio part. I just was thinking that being a game warden back in those early days, what was that like? What kind of things did you experience? I just think there might be stories. You went out there, and I don't know, to me that's just like the romantic era of the early days of Alaska.
Well, we are deputized, and we had a badge, but we didn't carry guns or anything. I don't think anybody ever caused much trouble. Ray, on his patrol trips, you know, now the state doesn't do patrol trips like they did in those days. The state hardly ever goes to a village. There'd have to be an awful, terrible violation there that the locals would complain about, before the estate guy would ever go there. Mm-hmm. And if he went there uninvited, why, look out for his tires or something. But but they respected law and order in those days. And Ray had a, usually had a snitch in about every village. That he, you know, he'd go around and talk to people and he could, you know, what was going on. There's none of that now, of course. And so that was kind of interesting. We I had an interesting thing happen when I was in the office one day at Eielson. Major in the air police, he was the major was in charge of the air police squadron, came to me, and I don't know where my assistant was then, but he said, I got a couple friends that were checked yesterday on the Salcha by by civilian game warden for licenses, and they didn't have any, but they told him that they had them, but they didn't have them on them. So he said, I'd like for you to issue a couple of licenses and to these guys who happen to be captains and backdate them.
Oh.
So I got thinking about that. We had a 4x4 issued to us, you know, to run around with. And, so I knew that Ray had worked with this, the colonel that was the base commander then, to get this thing started out there. So I felt fairly confident that he wasn't just kidding, you know. So I drove down and got an immediate appointment with the base commander. I told him what happened. I said, is this the way it's going to work, or or what? And so he said, no, that's not the way it's going to work. So within a few minutes, he had those three guys, a major and those two captains, in there and chewed them out good. That major couldn't have been more friendly to me the rest of the time, you know. So that turned out good, but it wouldn't necessarily had to be. It could have been something else, which case I probably wouldn't have wanted the job.
Now, when you describe patrols, the people just wouldn't necessarily stop into a village and talk to their contact. They might, on the way between villages, would they typically follow river corridors to look for hunting parties or go over major trap line trails to see about activity? Did you participate in any of those, working with Wolford? Or?
A few, but really not a lot. Most of my flying was with Frank. I had an airplane, and the agreement was they furnished me gas anytime I wanted to fly in him, or so that worked out pretty good. But Ray did a lot of trap line patrol work, and then he had a couple short timers come in right after, about even one of them while I was there. But Ray Tremley came along. He was an experienced trapper, and so Ray got into that a lot, and trap line patrol was certainly an important thing. In those days, you had that rule about not trapping within 25 feet of a beaver house, and so that was a pretty commonly violated thing, and so it was easy enough to spot those things. And I just really respect Ray for the way he he judged cases on their merit, and if the guy was tough and hard up, why, that would be considered and that type of thing. But if he's just an out-and-out violator, why, he'd get pinched. But those guys really knew what was going on in the country in those days, far more than they do now.
Those guys meaning the trappers or the wardens?
No, the game wardens.
So they patrol by airplane? So what if you're out, you're flying around and you see a party in violation, do you just land right there and walk up to them, or how does that work?
In some cases they would. If a guy was chopping some more beaver holes or something. But it wasn't hard to track it back to the village. Their trail, and of course, somebody in the village knew who that was out there and all that type of thing. So, yeah. And of course, they made trips in the spring to seal beaver hides. And so they were out a lot that way. And they got pretty cagey on spotting beaver hides that were taken after the season and and stove dried to make them seem like they're a little older. And, and a lot of times the dogs were sent in for wolf bounty.
Dog pelts?
Yeah. and so often Frank had to be pulled in, you know, is this a dog or is this a wolf? You know? There's a there's some coloration in toenails and various things, and I forget them. But yeah, they'd send in their whole wolves, and they would, let's see, in those days they cut off the left foreleg, the bone had to be left on, and they punch an ear, so that wolf couldn't be bounded again.
I remember one time at the federal building, you showed some footage of Frank Glazer administering a bison hunt down in Delta, I believe it was. I think he was helping the person spot it and stalk it and then skin it out. And were you involved with any of that while you worked as a warden?
Yeah, I was. The 2 years I was there, I was one of those guides. Those first 2 years of the hunt, the each hunter had to be accompanied by a designated guide, not a register guide or anything, but a department, usually a department of people. And some of the guys would come up from Anchorage and do that. And yeah, I did that for the two falls that did that. It was sometimes necessary because those, once in a while, those old bulls that they wanted to cull were by themselves, but quite often they were in a herd, and you'd finally get a shot, and then not too often did they fall in their tracks, and then they, right away they were mingled in with the rest, and maybe even run in the woods. We lost a couple that way, but it was useful to have a second gun. Yeah, Frank was down there. He's caught a guy. He was, I guess, like in his early 60s then. And he was a little bit of the, like, they knew that Joe Miner was coming on, and Frank was a little worried about his job. And but Clarence Rode told him that they'd become friends, you know. He told him, you don't have to worry about anything. You're going to be here at a retirement age. And he was. And,
Did you know Clarence Rode?
I met him a few times when he'd be in Fairbanks. And actually one time, two or three years after I was out of the Army, and he was in town, he called me up and wanted to know if I wanted to go on a survey flight with him in the Goose. And that trip we went up up on the NOATAC and up in that area, and looking for caribou. Their surveys were pretty rough in those days. We saw a heck of a bunch here, you know, and that kind of stuff. But Clarence was a guy that, well, he loved to fly, and he got out and did those things.
So that was prior to statehood, and he was with, again, the Bureau of Sport Fisheries and Wildlife, the federal government?
Yeah, he was regional director, regional
Alaska director.
Yeah, he was, and of course when he was killed in that accident, he had one of the guys from Fairbanks who had come on, that, see, this was, would be 150, 6, 7, 8, somewhere in there when he was killed.
58.
Why, one of the game wardens from Fairbanks was with him, along with his college-age son, who was just riding along. And they apparently tried to sneak over a pass in the Eastern Brooks and couldn't make a turn there. Pretty tragic thing.
Were you involved in the search for that?
No, they didn't want any single engine aircraft.
Okay.
The military handled department people and the military handled it. And it happened in late August, I believe, and or the first September, and the search went on well into the winter until they finally. Dan Ralston was head was enforcement supervisor for the state, and he became acting director when Clarence disappeared, and he finally called the search off in probably in November and figured that he was risking too many other lives to be out there then.
Is there an event that you can recall either in your work as a warden or your time as a guide where you were really frightened about something in terms of a close call when you were flying in poor weather or being out by the ocean when you're being out on the sea ice when you're hunting polar bears, something like that? Is there any particular thing that really strikes out at you as a very frightening experience? I don't mean to alarm your wife these old stories, but
it's all over with now.
It's all over with now.
There's a few flying things. I remember one time we were down on the peninsula.
And the Alaska Peninsula?
Yeah. Down around Port Hyden area or Moeller, somewhere in there. And we'd established a camp on a river bar, and I don't think it was Cinder River, but it was one of those. It was alongside of a hill, and one time I took off and a real downdraft was coming over the hill, and I was flying parallel to it and just barely off the ground, and that downdraft just tipped my wing right into the hill. And I, you know, it had low speed, but I had pretty much opposite controls in there trying to right the thing, and just before I hit the hill, it wind let loose and I was able to get away from it. And as far as polar bear hunting, there could have been a lot of problems there, but we were pretty lucky. I remember one time we were out and came back, and we kind of hit kind of fog, you know, a ground fog just 5 miles or so before we got back in. And coming back in was always kind of a questionable thing because we didn't have GPS or anything in those days. Pretty much a compass thing, you know. So when you hit something, you weren't sure. If you hit ground east of the barrel, it was flat, you know. It hardly made any difference if it was a whiteout from the sea ice to the tundra. But if you hit land south of barrel, southwest of barrel, well, there's a bluff there, a bit of a bluff. So that was a good thing. But anyway, we came back in okay that day through the fog, but we learned that Jules Thibodeau, who was kind of a notorious character in those days, he had persuaded an acquaintance to buy him 2 tater crafts so he could guide. Of course, he was acquainted with the North Slope a lot. He fiddled around up there a lot. And they were out in the same condition that day, and instead of coming into the fog, they elected to fly east along it and hoping to get a break to come inland. Well, they didn't. They got over around Lonely, and one of them ran out of gas, so we had to land, and it was not big enough pans, and they ran in the ice pressure ridge, and the other plane flew around for a few minutes and tried to land the same place. Well, the same thing happened to him. So they crashed both airplanes. And so then we were searching for 2 or 3 days. And actually, Bobby Fisher, who flew for ARL out of Burr.
Arctic Research Lab?
Yeah. He finally got far enough east to find them. And so those kind of things happen. And there are people that were drowned earlier. And we had one thing that could have been troublesome. There was various things you do for a polar bear, but one of the things you always hoped would happen is you're tracking a big track, and there's another sow track with it, and so in the spring, while the is breeding season for them, and so a boar will get on a sow track and follow it. He can tell which ones are which cells are in heat, and once in a while you reach a condition where he hasn't caught up with her yet, but you find her up there, so you know he's going to walk right on those tracks, you know. So you get a ways ahead and hide plane behind a pressure ridge and get ready. But in this case, we were not too far off of the Point Barrow and in that more active ice. And my partner had landed and went after a bear, and they got it quite a ways from the airplane. And so I was in the air watching what happened. And so then I eventually landed right near the hillside. And my partner decided that, you know, before we skinned the bear or anything, he'd go back and move his airplane up. So he did, and so then, you know, an hour and a half or so later, when we're a few skinning, well, he took off, and right where he had his airplane, the ice was crushing inward, and it looked like about 10 feet of, you know, deep, clear seawater over the ice there. So could have lost an airplane there. But that's the reason we always use two airplanes, is something happened, you could probably get people out of there.
So when you hunted polar bears then on the off the north coast of Alaska from when sometime in the 1960s up until the Marine Mammal Protection Act in 1972?
Yeah, actually the first year we went up was and just for a lark, and I took one polar bear, was 57.
Wow.
And that looked like an easy thing to do. So we did it every year until including the last year, 1972. Mm-hmm. And mostly out of Barrow in the earlier days, and then we had a good contact in Kaktovik that could get gas in for us in the summertime. And that was when there was way less hunting pressure out of there. It was a little tougher hunting because there was more wind and tracking was poor.
Yeah, at Kaktovik.
Kaktovik, yeah. Mm. But there wasn't any competition. And then the last year, just for the heck of it, I always heard about hunting out of Point Hope, and there'd been quite a bit of that. So we hunted there last year.
Mm. So what did you think of the Marine Mammal Protection Act? When it put you out of business, did you think it was unfair, discriminatory, or reasonable?
I was kind of ready to stop. Uh-huh. And again, the guides kind of didn't help their case any. I think it was Jack Lenfer was the principal biologist, mm-hmm. monitoring that stuff there, mm-hmm. And he began to see some bad stuff going on, you know, taking small bears and he got a bad taste in his mouth, and the rest of us, you know, couldn't refute some of that, and so I think he was probably somewhat instrumental in getting polar bear included in the Marine Mammals Act, and at least I know his testimony was pretty negative towards it. Mm-hmm.
When you were flying in and out of Barrow and Kaktovik and Point Hope as a guide, What was the reaction from the local community in relation with the Native people?
It seemed to be pretty accepted. We didn't ever have any conflicts that we knew about. The worst thing, again, giving it all a bad name, was there was quite a bit of drinking with some of the guiding outfits and hunters, and involved with the Native girls there. And so that was a bad aspect of it. And
so was there much interaction between the guides and the Native community, or you kind of went in, took your guys out, and left?
Well, pretty much. We happened to know, have contacts there with both the Presbyterian Church and the Assembly of God. So, of course, we ate in the restaurants, such as they were, a couple of them there, and stayed in the Top of the World Hotel. And there were a few Native women that did all the fleshing of hides.
Yeah.
That was something that nobody else could do. Tanneries wouldn't take them unless they were fleshed by Native, you know. And we got acquainted with quite a few of the Native people.
Mm-hmm. Now, were the women paid to do that?
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember who some of them were?
One of them was Charlie Edwardson's wife, and Charlie Edwardson had a junior that became a very active activist in Native rights, but...
that would be Mary Edwardson, I think was her name.
Probably, uh-huh. She did quite a few of ours,
and that was in Barrow?
In Barrow, yeah. And Faye Nushinginya, I think, did some. We never did a big volume. We tried to maybe do about three hunts, and that sometimes would take 3 weeks, at least 2 weeks, just waiting out weather.
Is that in April primarily?
Yeah, early April. And that one that year that Jules and his partner cracked up, they had about three hunters waiting there. So and had a very unusual situation. About that time that happened, there was about a 3 or 4 inch snowfall that didn't get blown away for a few days. So it was just like shooting ducks in a barrel. You go out and track a bear and a couple times a day, you know. So we took those three hunters, and so maybe we had six that year or something. But most of the time it was pretty small.
I wonder, how do you land an airplane out there on the ice? It's rough out there.
Well, there's the ice that's plenty good. The best ice is the ice, you know, the ice separates and you have leads that form all year long, and they begin to freeze again. And when it's about a foot of slushy ice, well, it begins to turn a little gray, and then by the time it begins to collect some frost on top and begins to get white, and not white as everything else, but kind of white, it's probably safe enough to land on. Those are just like landing fields, you know. But barring those, why the other condition is the pressure ridges from the previous winter, they kind of half melt down every year, and they're just harder than heck, you know, and rough. But there's some of the previous year's ice, like good pressure ridge or a lead ice, that are still there, and they're pretty good shape. And there's always wind, so you know, you only need a couple hundred feet or 300 feet. And the farther out you go, the more good ice there is.
You ever wreck an airplane?
Not so I couldn't fly at home.
Really?
One time I went out a hunt in the Brooks Range, a spring bear hunt with my son, the one that lives here, and we landed on a bar up on the middle fork of the Chandelier, and the right gear collapsed.
Mm.
It had been it was rusty inside the tubing.
Mm-hmm.
So there was timber there.
Mm-hmm.
So over the next couple of days, while we fashioned a new gear,
really?
Out of some spruce holes. Well, you split them and hollow them out and and put them around the, straighten out the bent tubing and lash it around, you know.
Really?
Wow. All that stuff. And got out of there, right?
Mm.
Well, it wasn't uncommon to, when we were wolf hunting, to break a safety cable on a gear or even a Cobain V on the gear. But you could, there was always two airplanes and enough guys lift the wing up and rope it back together and get somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Did you consider that high risk flying, that aerial wolf hunting?
Yeah, it could be if getting a wolf became more important than than using good sense. You know? Yeah, most of the guys I knew that were killed, well, one of the department guys, what was his name? Toby was his last name. He was killed over in the Meadow Flats, I think, doing it as a in his own time or something. And Jim Falls, he worked for the CAA at Bethel's. We were on that search for him one time. And that was kind of interesting search. Expecting to be up in the Bettles River country, so that's where we all searched for 2 or 3 weeks. We didn't search that long, but people were searching that long. And flying over the place where he crashed many, many times, people did. Well, it turned out that probably he was in a turn or something, and he ran out of gas, and they stalled and just spun into timber alongside the river, pretty heavy black spruce. And one of the guys, apparently Jim was flying, he was killed instantly. His nephew, who'd come up just to hunt wolves with him, had gotten out. He tried to fashion a little tent, you know. Well, they had a tent. And he kind of got it halfway set up, but it looked like he didn't stay in it. And then he walked down on the river and walked up a little ways, and he was found frozen to death by a clump of a root ball of a spruce tree. And so anyway, what happened was, after everybody searched for a while and didn't find him, they gave up the search, and the relatives in Minnesota prevailed upon their congressman or somebody to reactivate it. So by that time, the snow was about half melted, and they sent a C-130 up the Bellows River, and right away they spotted that green cub down in that spruce. Yeah, and everything else was obvious then. So they were wolf hunters.
Yeah. Well, that year you flew out of Onaktuvik, how many wolves did you get?
We hunted, I think, 2 years out of Onaktuvik, and 1 year we got 56 wolves in 5 days of hunting.
5 days. That's with a pair of cubs, there,
yeah.
Right? So you were always the pilot, not the gunner, or?
No, I was often the gunner.
Oh, I see.
Clue McMahon from the Kona area, he was a guy down there. He had actually, I think the first guy that we know of that did any area wolf hunting was Ward Gay. And Cleo was a friend of his, and he had a J3 at Gulcana then, and he got to hunting down the Copper River country and by himself. And he had a stiff left arm from a break when he was a kid, but he could still shoot with one hand out of the side of the cub.
So he'd fly with his left hand and the control stick and the throttle and have to shoot with his right.
Or kind of grab it between his legs too, you know, the stick. And you trimmed them so when you let loose the things, it kind of wanted to climb. It worked really well. But So anyway, I knew Cleo, mm-hmm. and he'd heard about the big hunt by your department out of Umiat, mm-hmm. 52, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Operation Umiat, yeah.
Yeah, one or two, 51 or mm-hmm. two, because I was in the office. Mm-hmm. And so he wanted to go up there and hunt wolves, but he'd never gotten farther than Fairbanks to bring his airplane up for annuals. Mm. So I said, well, heck, we can, I've been around the Brooks a little bit, let's go. So my guiding partner was Leroy Schiebel, and so we had, in fact, had three airplanes, but Cleo and I would usually, he could, I think he had some success shooting by himself, but he didn't shoot very well when he was flying with me. Mm. So more often than not, I shot and he flew, whichever one of our planes we were using. Mm.
At one point, I remember hearing that there was oil exploration up on the North Slope in some earlier period, and there were some gas caches still left over from that. And were you able to use that?
Oh yeah, that was the key to the whole thing, learning where those caches were. Mm. There was all kinds of gas. There was some that was pink, like 80 octane, but it was called 80 all purpose. Hmm. It was, and they had that out for mainly for weasels and things that they used up there. But they also, there was quite a bit of 91 octane, mm-hmm. and there was even some 115, 130.
Wow.
And there's also usually some blazo around. Hmm. So when you learn where those caches were, well, of course the barrels were, if there was a second tier of them, well, you could manage them. But the ones that were just on the ground, they were put in by big float planes at the edge of lakes, you know. Mm. Well, they'd be frozen in the tundra. So we just carried an axe along and chopped a couple slits in them and got a wobble pump in there, you know. Mm. And so if we were going to use 115 octane, why, we dilute that with a little blazo, you know, and that kind of stuff. And some of that gas is pretty old then, and one of our guys that went with Leroy a lot, my partner, was Bud Wheezy. He managed the Chevron bulk plant here. So he one time he took some samples of some of it and sent it in their lab, and they said it was all good stuff. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You said a good chamois filter or some way to make sure that you...
Yeah, oh yeah, we chamoyed it. Uh-huh. Mm.
Now, at one point, too, I had heard that on in terms of some of the spreading of the strychnine baits, was there actually use of a fairly large military aircraft at some point on some of that?
I think that was a one-time thing. It was kind of interesting. I actually have a copy out of Frank's diary of that.
Frank Glasser's diary?
Yeah, mm-hmm. of his version of it. And I'm going to tell you what I remember, and in fact, I think I can find it if you want to look at or copy it for you. There was a bunch of buffalo killed on the Delta River, probably either by a bombing run, or I think it was a way. Anyway, they were some of the meat was salvaged, or parts of the salvation. They brought in the lad, and so there. Who was a commander out there? Gaffney was originally, you know, but I think it was a different colonel at that time. Anyway, Frank had the idea of baiting up a bunch of this. I'm sure it was buffalo. I don't think it was moose, but meat and dropping it out of the plane. So they loaned him a B-24, and he was up in front, and they told the guy in the bomb bay, you know, when to start pushing the stuff out. And what they did, they dropped it along Iowa Ridge.
Oh, right here in Tannenhof, just south of the Tannenhof Flats in the foothills.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Frank walked in the next summer, and he found several carcasses there, because that was kind of a major... Mm. That ridge is kind of a major wolf run, you know. Mm.
This would have been in the 50s sometime then.
It was before 50, because Frank told me about it.
Okay.
And, you know, by 51. And I told, you know, Jim Reardon wrote that book about Frank finally, and I kept urging Jim to do that, and he said, well, I he'd already written several short stories of, from Frank's conversations in outdoor magazines, and he said, well, I've got some of those I could use for chapters, but I don't have really what I need to tie it all together with, you know. He says, I'm looking for Frank's diary. And of course, employees have to write itineraries of their trips in those days. Maybe you do now, I don't know. But so Jim checked Juneau in Washington, D.C., and he couldn't find anything Frank had submitted. But finally, just kind of by accident, I think, Frank's doctor in Anchorage, before Frank died, Frank had given him his diary, his personal diary. So this doctor loaned it to Jim, and Jim went through it and typed out a bunch of stuff that was interesting, you know. And one of them was this story about dropping those bombing those wolves over there with that bait. So Jim didn't use it in his book, of course, but he sent me a copy of it because he said, I never believed it was true, but here it is, you know.
So these would have been strychnine baits dropped in the wintertime.
Right? Yeah.
Now, when you were involved as a warden and you may have gone on, Frank, with some of these flights, did you ever see other animals that were poisoned, like bears? If the baits weren't picked up by wolves, they might be subsequently picked up by bears when they came out of the den. Did you ever see any evidence of that?
Well, no, I didn't. But I'm sure it happened some. For instance, the consensus was that grizzly along Beaver Creek were diminished quite a bit by the work there. Although by the time we were hunting on Beaver Creek for moose, they'd certainly rebounded.
And when would that, roughly when would it have been that time period?
Well, that would have been in the probably the 80s, late 70s and 80s. My partner, Leroy Shebel, had a cabin there that's still there, you know, just below the Big Bend. And we used that as a jump-off place for moose hunts. And any time you left a moose, a pile of guts overnight, you go back the next day, they had been visited by grizzly. And even though you didn't very often see them, There was just a lot of bears then by that time again. But to answer your question, Frank recognized that wherever he had a bait set, and they weren't like every 10 miles or anything like that, there'd be one in the Upper Chena, you know, and one on Beaver Creek and like that. But that's all it took, you know. But you'd lose all the foxes within 5 miles or so. But their instructions was to put those out on rivers and lakes so they'd be kind of self-destructing in the spring.
Okay.
But occasionally Frank couldn't resist if he had a nice fresh moose kill out in the flats here. And if he could land, he preferred to put the baits out, you know, in an orderly fashion. They were... When he could get seal blubber, he used seal blubber and cut it about an inch square, poke a hole and put these strychnine pellets in. They're about like an aspirin tablet, you know. And when he couldn't get seal blubber, he'd use lard and cut it in cubes and fix them and pour some seal oil on them there. And then had them in brown paper sacks, you know, maybe 20 to a sack. And if we could land, he would put these round a big circle, you know. And the wolves will always come back to a kill, even if it's completely cleaned up. And they approach it cautiously. Anyway, it worked better out. So it wasn't uncommon to come back later, and here would be 8 or 10 wolves dead. Or if they laid down, take them about 30 minutes. Or if they didn't rest there and went on, you didn't have to track them very far for the beginning to drop off. So that way you got a lot. But
So it wasn't, sometimes I've heard that there was more of a grid pattern where they would just systematically go along and place them, but what you're suggesting is they were really trying to focus in where they would find a kill.
There are always kills, okay. In my experience.
Okay.
I read where the Fish and Wildlife Service was prohibited or by the Park Service to not drop those baits in Denali or McKinley Park. So they flew along the north boundary and kind of left a line of them. Did you hear about that and the conflict between the Park Service and the Fish and Wildlife?
No, not really. Mm-hmm. There any trips I made with Frank, the thing I was going to say, the other thing, if he couldn't land, why, he would drop these sacks out at a kill. Mm. So, but I was never with him on the border of McKinley Park. And I was in various other places, including clear down the Ladue drainage, you know, down in Northwind, things like that. But what did I diverse? What was it?
No, you were kind of describing, I was asking a little bit about how the technique was done. And when you worked with Frank, that was a real advantage of the airplane, because prior to having aircraft access, he would have had to travel by dog team or something to find these or have people report them, whereas in an airplane, you could fairly quickly cover the river corridors, spot kills, and go ahead and set them up.
That's often where kills were, mm-hmm. because a moose would, they kind of come to the rivers for the willow in the mm-hmm. winter anyway, but a kill would eventually, a moose would back up into the cut bank and make his last stand, you know, and he'd be on the river. I used to think originally, if there's that many kills along these rivers, they must be everywhere, you know. But the fact is, there's far more kills along rivers than there were in the open country, you know. So that's what you did. The exception to that, of course, like to say, the use of cyanide guns in the summertime, they were just put along ridges. He'd sometimes hike a long ways off of off the road to find a good ridge that a wolf might travel, and particularly around Delta, he got quite a few wolves and coyotes on those tri bars there, you know. Mm. But there's one funny thing that happened after I was with him. Joe Minard come along, and he was working the 40-mile country quite a bit with the airplane, and he put out some cyanide guns up on the upper Charlie River. And there was a guy in town that, his name was Pete Gatz. He was the Internal Revenue guy here, and kind of a one-man office then. And he and some friends went up the Charlie in a boat in the fall, and Joe would put out these little signs, you know, near, not right at, but near a getter, saying what it was. Mm-hmm. Don't disturb it, and it's government property. And anyway, Pete reaches down and pulls one of these things. And, you know, they were, in those days, it was a 38 case with a little bit of black powder and a wad and the cyanide, and then a tar wad in the end of it. So there's enough force to put the tar wad to break the skin on Pete's thing, and then somebody sees the sign, you know, cyanide. Mm. So they rush Pete down to the boat and down the circle and tear into town full speed in the hospital, and Pete's still alive. Mm. And of course, there wasn't any chance anything happening. You'd have to get it in your mouth, and the moisture has to turn it to gas, and you have to gulp it. So anyway, Pete survived, but he was sure mad. he raised heck with Ray over that.
Mm. Did you ever hear Frank talking about whether bears would ever actually pull on those to like a canid would? Or
yeah, he told me about one time on they first opened the 40-mile road. In about 48 or something like that, they pushed that road through the chicken. And so there was quite a bit of grader you know, use on the road. And he said the wolf tracks were just terrible along the road. So he did quite a little bit of work for a couple of years there. And he said one time a gun was pulled off the side of the road, and I don't remember why, but anyway, it was in black spruce, that's all there is over there, somewhere between Mount Fairplay and Chicken. And so he was crawling through the black spruce there with, you know, with his gun in one hand, like looking for what might have pulled it. And he came right square face to face with this sow grizzly laying there. So like 6-8 feet away. So he just shoots her, you know.
So she was still alive yet?
Oh, she was alive, but it killed one of her cubs.
The poison head.
Yeah. So he was going to take a chance with her.
Yeah.
What was Frank's attitude towards wolves? You read about people that were wolf control agents hated them and have a vicious attitude. Was that his attitude, or was it just a job?
It was just a job, I think. Uh-huh. He was a natural woodsman, one of the last in the country, really. You know, he'd walked up the highway from Valdez and thinking, was kind of enthralled with that Black Rapids country, and actually he owned that roadhouse there for a year or two.
Oh, he did?
Yeah. And he market hunted in the area for the road commission. Then he later went and settled over on Savage River and trapped there for 10 years or so. And then he got this job, and they first sent him to around the reindeer herds on the Seward Peninsula. Oh. But he was trapping with steel traps then, and trying to teach the Eskimos to use them. But he did have, he got his first cyanide guns over there, because he told me about some Eskimo dog team that, or I don't know if it was a leader or what, pulled one, and the guy was madder than heck over it, you know. And he said, you know, what you've done is you've destroyed government property, and I won't do anything about it if we just keep this quiet this time, you know, but you can't do that. So, no, I don't think it was just a job with Frank. He didn't have any terrible vendetta, I guess.
I have a question. You were talking before about game wardens and respect for the law. One case that comes to mind is the Duck Inn in Barrow, where the community went against the game warden. And I wonder what your thoughts are on that. We hear commonly about the native perspective on it, but we haven't heard so much what the game warden side to that might be.
Well, that was after my time, too. But a couple of the natives, you know, shot ducks all they could in the spring. So they thought they'd make a test case, as I remember it, and a couple of the wardens went up there and arrested somebody. And the next day, about half the town showed up with a duck in his hand and wanting to get arrested. And the net result was they just backed away from it. It wasn't a winnable case. You know.
Were there other cases like that where people went against the game wardens?
No, I don't know of any. Like I say, my experience in the interior was a lot of respect, actually.
We have 8 minutes of tape if you have anything else you want to say in 8 minutes.
I don't.
No, I think you covered it very well, unless you had any other final thoughts. I mean, you've covered a lot of very interesting material. It's very valuable for, you know, the wildlife profession to have this historical perspective on things, because we hear a lot of various things of what some people perceive happened in the old days, like with a lot of the predator control programs and poison. It's very good to hear your perspective on it. I had actually used the coyote guns out in the Aleutian Islands for Arctic fox removal from some of the seabird colonies, and had many of this, what you described is exactly how we would use them as well.
Did you use the newer type that were just spring-loaded?
Yes, the spring-loaded ones.
Well, you know, people, I suppose, think that maybe some of those have been used up here because they're readily attainable in the States, you know. If you're a rancher or something, you can use them. But Frank found out early on that the amount of load of cyanide in them that they're using in the States would not kill a wolf. And so they had to make special loads for him, for wolves. They'd occasionally make him sick for a little while, but he said they'd just get up and leave after a while. And so I assume probably the same thing would be true of the newer type. Instead of using the 38 cartridge of powder, where now it's just a strong spring that throws the stuff out through the end, and probably wouldn't be very effective.
Well, Chuck, thank you very much. This has been a pleasure for me to hear a lot of what you had to say about history up here in the interior area back for the last 50 years or so. It's very valuable to us. I really appreciate it.
I guess it's an honor to do it.
Thanks.